Five Characters in Search of an Exit, besides being an awesome title, was written by Rod Serling based upon an unpublished short story by Marvin Peddle called The Depository. He had showed it to Serling at a party, and he liked it and told him to pass it along to see if the studio would be willing to buy it. It's a bottle story and proves, once again, that bottle stories can be very effective if you know how to do them right. In other words, if you know how to place the emphasis upon character. We begin with a soldier unconscious in a round room with an open ceiling. He wakes up clearly confused by his predicament, feeling along the walls in a way that shows he is becoming an ever more desperate man, or else he's an absolutely terrible mime. Just remember, first rule of Mime Club is... He soon comes across what is perhaps the only thing that might be worse than a mime to be trapped with, a clown. Basically, a mime that you can't shut up. Our soldier soon is revealed to be a major after the clown screws around with him. And the major has no idea who he is or how he came to be here. And the clown is like, "Oh, you must be like the rest of us." Yes, a clown and a bagpiper. Whoever put the major here obviously has no regard for the Geneva Convention. There's also a hobo here and a ballerina who addresses his question, or rather, his crazed outburst. Where are we? Who are we?
We're nameless things with no memory, no knowledge of what went before, no understanding of what is now. No knowledge of what will be.
The wonderful title is inspired by a work by Luigi Pirandello called Six Characters in Search of an Author, likely chosen because of the theater of the absurd that Pirandello operated in, which ties into what we are witnessing. Like the theater of the absurd, this episode has an existential element to it. Think of how aptly the description for what these five people are fits to us as human beings. We come into this world with no knowledge of what comes before or after, only what other people might tell us, religion or philosophy or science. Likewise, the theater of the absurd is about the interactions between people, quite often more than about advancing the plot. You might have heard of the famous play Waiting for Godot. Well, the title tells you everything. It's about the conversation had while waiting for the title character who never arrives. It is considered one of the finest examples of this school. Likewise, we have our characters trapped with no idea how they got here or how to get out.
We're here because we're here because we're here. Because we're here.
Everyone agrees that the Tautological Society has the most annoying anthem ever. Lamont Johnson, who directed, had plenty of experience with the theater of the absurd as well, and considers this episode his favorite. In addition, the episode also draws comparison, as you might imagine, to the classic Sartre play No Exit, about three people in hell, for whom the suffering is imposed simply by the presence of the other two, leading to the famous quote, "Hell is other people." But the idea likely is drawn from the fact that this feels like they're trapped in hell, just a nowhere place with nothing but four strangers for company. Four strangers throwing out various ideas about their predicament. They're on a spaceship, in a dream, or part of someone's imagination. We're in the limbo after death. People throw out answers because they don't actually have answers. In fact, they raise more questions that can't be answered.
Do you feel hungry, Major? Or thirsty? Or heat, or cold, or fatigue, or discomfort.
Or anything.
Hence the selection of options. Almost all of them allow for you to not need sustenance and explains why there are no normal sensations. All his suggestions of what to do, they have already tried. Nothing ever bore fruit. But what is shocking is an ear-splitting giant bell. But if anyone rings it, they cannot hear the major's cries for help. So they try to pass time watching the ballerina dance while the piper plays. The ballerina is played by Susan Harrison, given top billing because at the time she was actually the bigger star, even though the major is clearly the main character. Serling approached her for this role based upon her performance in the Playhouse 90 production of In Lonely Expectation. The Major is played by William Wyndham, who is most likely known to my audience as Commodore Decker, another mad military man in Star Trek's Doomsday Machine. Anyway, the ballerina has a thought on their situation.
Perhaps there are a lot of dungeons like this. Perhaps they're for the unloved.
Yep, I saved this episode for all of you alone on Thanksgiving to enjoy. While the work draws upon the theater of the absurd, that doesn't mean that they limit this to the boundaries of the stage. Just take a look at this shot. I mean, look how beautifully this is framed, and not something that can have the same power in a theatrical work. So even though there's a taste of the stage in this work, Johnson takes advantage of the power of the camera when he can. This is when the Major makes the pronouncement that they are in hell. I mean, that is especially apt given the ballerina's remark from a little while ago. Hell may bring to mind images of fire and pitchforks and torment, but it is often thought that hell is to be separated from the love of God. After the commercial break, the Major continues to work on a way out, prompting more sarcasm from the clown. But his remark about acrobatics and jest makes the ballerina think that they might have hit upon an answer. But the clown can offer no help in how acrobatics might work, because he hasn't the foggiest idea about how circuses work. He doesn't even recall what it's like to be a clown. He merely knows he is a clown because he is currently dressed as a clown, and so he acts like a clown. We play the role that we are given. And this role, by Murray Matheson, is played with style. Serling writes him as a typical Shakespearean clown, and the British accent employed, Matheson was actually from Australia, adds to that archetype nicely. So the plan is to stack themselves up so that the ballerina is on top and can try to reach the top of the wall. Now, this was achieved by having a second wall built that could be tilted so that the actors aren't bearing the full weight of the ones above them, but to also not look like they were lying on the floor either. Anyway, the ballerina climbs up, but comes up about one hand short, and when the bell rings, they all come crashing down, her leg getting hurt in the process. But it was so close, the Major feels they can make it if he uses rope and the broken sword to serve as a hook and line to get himself over the top. Then he can see about freeing the others. After several failed attempts, it finally gains purchase, and he's able to climb up and... Well, that was a very unsatisfying ending. Oh no, there's more. The Major is spotted in the snow where he lands, only the girl who spots him sees him as he truly is, a doll. They all are, sitting in a barrel, part of a drive to give to orphans as presents for Christmas. The giant bell is the one that the woman rings to alert people to donate more dolls. But while it seems a sad fate, and we see them now in their true doll appearance as well, the ballerina takes the Major's hand and sheds tears. Yet Serling offers the hope that if they are unloved, that it's only temporary, as to be in the arms of a child is to know nothing but love. The dolls are actually life-size mannequins with beautiful masks crafted by Charles Schramm, who wasn't credited for this work, but still, he based it upon the actors' actual faces, and it really turned out well, to nevertheless look like them even though they are clearly false. This episode is strongly recommended, not for its twists, but rather for the very experience of it. Everyone is in top form, from Serling to Johnson to his crew to the actors. There are no missteps here. This may be a story about archetypes, but what we see is that people who are nothing but archetypes are nevertheless people with desires and questions and wanting answers. They take these ciphers and they give them a three-dimensional aspect to it that makes them literally come alive. This is a deep and fascinating journey, which of course is what the Twilight Zone is.